Son, did you steal? Come on, son, raise up your head. It is well with you in Jesus' name.
I said it. That man is not to be trusted.
Now see what he has done to the church.
The shame he has brought upon the church. The chief protocol officer of the church, for that matter.
Imagine.
Thank God I'm not good. How could an unworthy vessel be trusted with God's work?
How can God even be allowing all this rubbish to be happening in the house of God?
Have you forgotten what the Bible says?
But in the great house there are not only vessels of gold and of silver, but of wood and of earth.
Some want to honor and some want to dishonor. That is why daily purging is inevitable.
No wonder the Bible says, for it is time for judgment to begin with the household of God.
Yes. But if the judgment begins with us, what will be the outcome of those people who disobey the gospel of God?
Chief protocol
and disappointed.
I can't still believe.
Oh no.
I can't wait.
Hello, viewers at home. You're welcome back to your favorite show in this family. I remain your host, Peculiar Treasure. This is GPTIM, and today we are discussing the stray sheep. I have in the studio with me today Minister Priscilla. Minister Priscilla will be talking to us about the stray sheep. All right, Minister Priscilla, the last time we were talking about this, you said a stray sheep is that which has wandered off or strayed away or gone away. Can you please share more light for us on this?
Yes, it means it is a sheep that has strayed away or that has gone astray or that has drifted from the right path.
Okay, Minister Priscilla, can you please tell us what can make a sheep to stray away?
We may need to consider the reasons from three perspectives.
Can we?
Yes, of course. From the perspective of the shepherd. And second, from the perspective of the other 99 sheep. Yeah. And third, from the perspective of the stray sheep itself. And from the perspective of the shepherd, some shepherds are so careless and insensitive to know when a sheep is lost or not. Scripture admonishes that a shepherd should know the state of his flocks. In Proverbs chapter 27, verse 23. However, in this passage we are considering today, we realize that a shepherd is a good shepherd, as it takes only a good shepherd, a vigilant and a caring shepherd, to know that a sheep is lost out of 100.
Mm.
And from the angle of the sect of the 99 sheep,
yeah,
they had a duty to be their brother's keeper, but they failed woefully in this responsibility.
My dear, in this time that we are, any soul that strays away does it at his own risk.
And how do you mean?
Who has time to be running after a careless soul? Everybody is after his or her own welfare.
You mean the other sheep are supposed to be their brother's keeper?
Yes, of course.
Really?
Yes. What obtains now? Selfishness has become the basic problem of many family members. Who cares? And from the angle of the stray sheep. Scripture speaking in John chapter 10 verse 27. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. This shows that it is only a sheep that hears the shepherd's voice that will follow the shepherd. If you see a stray sheep, you can no longer hear the voice of the shepherd, or a stranger's voice.
Wow. A stranger's voice, you mean?
Yes, 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 very well. Some persons claim to be hearing voices. But you know, it isn't the voice of the good shepherd, scripture speaking. He took all the sheep out. He went before them. And they followed him. Why? Because they recognized his voice. The sheep will not follow strangers. Instead, they will run away from him because they do not recognize his voice.
So from what you just said, I could pick some points. I got them jotted down here. You said a good shepherd should not be careless about the sheep. You also said that the sheep should learn how to care for one another. And you also said that the sheep should know the voice of the shepherd and should be able to differentiate between the two.
Yes,
yes. The shepherd.
Yes.
Oh, all right, as we round off, can you please say something about this? Don't you think that the rescue mission of the shepherd could endanger the lives of the other 99 sheep? This is just one sheep out of 99 that has strayed, leaving 99 sheep in the pasture field. Going out after one sheep, is the risk worth it in any way?
A good shepherd knows that a sheep apart from his shepherd is defenseless and in grave danger.
But that is not my point. My point is 99 out of 100. I mean, is it worth it? Why bother over one? Anybody that has caused 99 out of 100 has gotten an excellent result as far as anybody is concerned.
I understand how you feel. But the vision of the good shepherd is in John chapter 6 verse 39. And I shall lose none of all that he has given me. What the shepherd did was to put the sheep in a sheepfold where they could be protected. He also put them in an open pasture where they could be well fed. In those days, shepherds used to have sheepdogs. Now, the function of the sheepdog was to guide the sheep in the absence of the shepherd. So the shepherd must have put a sheepdog in the midst of the sheep while he went in search of the stray sheep. It is the job of every shepherd to prevent and protect his sheep from being a prey. Scripture speaking, in 1 Samuel chapter 17, verse 34 to 36. David endangered his life to protect his sheep by facing lion and bear. Furthermore, in Psalms chapter 78, verse 72, scripture records, David shepherded the sheep with a pure heart and with skillful hands. If a shepherd will succeed in his assignment, it would require a pure heart, a pure motive, and essential skills.
Viewers at home, I can see that you are really learning. This is so educative. But Minister Priscilla, the scripture gives no indication at all of the shepherd ever chiding or even rebuking the sheep for being lost. Any explanation to that?
No. I want you to know that a stray sheep must have gone through a lot. A good shepherd will not despise the stray sheep when it's being rescued.
With a heart full of compassion
and filled with joy, will he rescue the sheep? Do you know what it means to have an adult sheep carried on the shoulders? Do you know how much it weighs? It will be no small effort to have a sheep carried on the shoulders. For joy over finding that which was lost, the shepherd bears discomfort. So the rescue of the lost sheep was a cause for proclamation and great celebration.
Wow. Mr. Priscilla, thank you very much.
No problem.
Thank you so much for showing up. I hope when we call you next time, you'll be here to answer us.
Well,
viewers at home, this is where we'll be drawing the curtain on today's show. I'm sure you have learned so much. I have also learned so much. We remain your favorite channel, GPTIM, and I remain your favorite anchor, Peculiar Treasure. Till we meet next time, next week, keep enjoying the grace of God in this family. Don't forget, love is our watchword. Bye.
Lord, I want to be like Jesus.
Jesus.
In my heart. Lord, I want to be like Jesus. In my heart.
Lord, I want to be like Jesus in my heart.
That is exactly what we are saying. This is the Bible. The Bible says, let this mind be in you, which also was in Christ Jesus. Only you know what? I think we need to intercede for every stray sheep of this house. Please, let's pray. Jesus, we ask that you forgive us.
Yes.
In his family.
Yes. Okay, 10 a.m. tomorrow morning, my office. Thank you.
My dear?
Yes?
Please don't grant the interview.
Why?
Are you asking why?
Yes, why?
The news is all over town that we have big mansion and exotic cars because we breed thieves in the church.
Eh? So do you believe that we're actually breeding thieves in our church?
Whether or not I believe it or that we breed thieves is not the issue right now.
So what is the matter? The truth is that Untuba Welen Luma Fenue so. Okay? Leave them, that's their fundamental human right. Let them say whatever they want to say.
The issue is that the chief protocol officer has brought shame to the church and also to the name of the body of Christ.
Don't say that! Never! The name of the Lord is forever incorruptible. Let me tell you, the truth of the matter is that the Lord will build his church and the gates of hell shall never prevail against it, as he will continually wash his body with his word, for he is coming for a church without blemish, wrinkle, or any such thing. Now wait, you will see. This has happened many times in the body of Christ, but the church has always bowed back. And watch, the church will continue to prosper.
Amen. But my dear, don't you think you are being too spiritual?
Oh, you would rather I be carnal, what?
No, please, I just want you to apply wisdom. Ibukuni for more do not to fogmoshi. And even if you must grant the interview, please deny him. And protect our name and the name of the Lord.
Hey! Who can protect his own name, not to talk of protecting God's name? Look! My own God has the capacity to defend and to protect his own name. Have you forgotten what the Bible says in Ezekiel chapter 36, verses 21 to 23? Can you bring the Bible? Let's read it together. Yes.
Please pass my glasses.
Thank you. I'll read verses 21 to 23. I had concern for my holy name, which the house of Israel profaned among the nations where they had gone. Therefore said to the house of Israel, this is what the sovereign God says. It is not for your sake, O house of Israel, that I'm going to do these things, but for the sake of my holy name, which you have profaned among the nations where you have gone. I could go on and on. Look, any God who needs to solely rely on his followers to defend his name cannot be considered powerful. My God is the one that answers by fire and is able to defend his own name.
Okay, my dear. Please, protect our name.
In this family? Capital no.
How do you mean, my dear? The boy even called you daddy outside. Is that not shameful enough?
Yes! He called me daddy because he's my son.
A thief, your son. Wale, a thief, your son.
Yes? You just called him a thief now. But I call him my son. Bible says whatever Adam called a thing, that's the name it bore.
Sorry, but I...
No. Even the thief that called upon Jesus on the cross of Calvary at the 11th hour of his life received mercy. Jesus did not cast him away. Ah, did he?
It is well.
So, did you steal? Come on, son, raise up your head. It is well with you in Jesus' name.
Daddy! You even told him to raise his head. Someone that should bow his head in shame.
Have you forgotten how Jesus needed to bow his head when attending to the woman people caught in adultery? The revelation in that account is that Jesus had to bow his head instead in order for her to look up. Look, sin makes people bow according to what Psalm 40 verse 12 says, that my iniquities have overtaken me so that I am not able to look up. Jesus bowed his head so that woman caught in adultery could raise our head up. We are good at casting aspersions and condemning people, adding more to people's trauma. We want them permanently in a position of shame with our own comments and attitude and judgment. God, on the other hand, wants them in an upright position to be in the right standing with him. That's why Jesus needed to take our place, so that we can look up to him and be focused.
Love is our watchword in this family. We are one.
The chief protocol officer of the cathedral, Mr. Tolu Adeyi, who is known with the reputable man of God, has been arrested. He was discovered to be one of the three people who stole 50 million naira from the government office. The shocking part of the story is that the man couldn't deny the allegation in any way.
Problem kan soso ti mo ni pelu Jesu ni pe ko nse interview ko to gba yan iru wa ogiri wa ina mi. My God.
No screening, no interview, nothing.
Jesus does not interview people before he accepts them into his fold.
Oh my God. He should be doing that, ke? Abba.
Really?
Yes, now. Assuming he does interview people before he accepts them into his fold.
Kone man gbaru awon eyan raga raga doju ti gbagbo yi. Eh?
All these sick and good for nothing people
causing shame here and there, they wouldn't have been qualified.
You know what? It is his grace that qualifies, not works.
Yes, I know. But they shouldn't take his grace for granted. Abba.
It's true. It's true. But calm down.
I will.
There's I love
The senior pastor, who is fondly called Daddy by all the members, was later interviewed by our reporter.
Was arrested in your church and even called you Daddy. What do you have to say about that?
Point of correction. That young man is not a thief by destiny. That was what the devil wanted to make of him. But I can tell you, he has a glorious destiny. The devil from the beginning has been trying his best to deform that which God has formed. For the fact that someone falls doesn't make him or her a failure. Even though my son has fallen, I can boldly assure you that he will rise up again. For a just man, the Bible says, falleth seven times and riseth up again in the book of Proverbs. Even though he's told, which of course is bad, I condemn the act, but not the actor.
Are you now supporting him, or can we say that that's what you teach your members in your church?
My sister, have you ever seen a father, even though very bad, who wants his son to turn out to be like him? Except maybe on few occasions, very rare. For those fathers that ended up even as polygamists will beg their sons not to take their path. Likewise also, no pastor, I repeat, no pastor will boldly stand on the pulpit and teach his members to do evil. Let's even say it happens. The Bible, the Word of God, is the standard of every Christian, and Jesus is our perfect example. Paul says in God's Word that we should follow him as he followed Christ, meaning when you see me not following Christ again, you have the liberty to change your route. Okay? That's it.
Sir, but we all know that children learn faster and better by observing their parents rather than what their parents teach them.
True again, but not 100% correct. We all know that our children sometimes manifest some of the things they copy from the society. Sometimes we are the product of the environment that brings us up. Even though he's my son, but I didn't teach him to go and steal because I have not been stealing myself. He probably copied that from the other kingdom. You remember Samuel in the Bible? 1 Samuel chapter 8 verse 2 says his sons did not know his ways, for they followed after unlawful gains and took bribes and they perverted justice. It was their choice, because man is a free will agent. Samuel could confidently ask the people openly, whose ox have I taken, or from whose hand have I received bribe to blind my eyes with? Let me say, peradventure, I was even doing that. Anything won konika to gba o fe se tinu eni. Yes, many bad people, children turned out good because they are determined to be good. It all borders on individual choices, you know.
But sir, we're told that you usually raise big offerings regularly in your church. Probably your chief protocol officer was trying to belong, and he had no choice than to steal.
Oh God, that again, I can tell you, is the attack from the pit of hell. Thank you.
How do you mean, sir? How do you mean? Would you like to throw more light on that?
My sister, that one you cannot understand. But I want you people to know that our manual does not encourage anyone to give under compulsion. Let every man be persuaded in himself or herself according to your own ability. Look, God sees the heart. The widow's mite was more appreciated than those with big offerings, meaning that God is more concerned about the motive and sacrifice behind our offerings. In the Bible, Apostle Paul talked about Macedonia people that gave out of little. The quantity though very good, but quality really matters. No pastor, I mean no real pastor, will force his members to give what they can't afford and cause them to go and steal in order to give towards the work of God, when he knows that God will eventually judge them for doing such. If you don't give your tithe, It's not by force. It's only that the blessing that follows the instructions won't follow you also. If you say it's applicable under the Old Testament, fine. Keep it there. It's not by force. First fruits, tithe, offering, etc., etc. is not by force, but by choice, because we are free moral agents. God does not force people to do His will. No one is forcing anybody to pay by force. As long as the earth remains, whatever you sow, that you also reap.
We are heirs of the kingdom.
Thank you. Very grateful. Thank you so much.
What do you have to say about this offense you were accused of?
And it is the devil.
Are you saying you actually stole the money? How did you organize the release? Did you bribe them to release him? Are you sure this is not arranged? Are you sure this is not planned? Excuse me, sir. Hello, sir. Are you sure you don't know about this stolen money?
My dear, what's our society turning to? All the people that we're supposed to trust, look at the way they are just falling cheaply. Anyway, that's why I don't trust any one of them. Most especially this so-called religious group. They are all fake.
Rubbish.
Oh yeah.
Arrant nonsense. Imagine, after deliberately doing something wrong, you'll be pointing an accusing finger to the devil.
Before,
accusing the accuser himself. I don't know. Is that what they are teaching them in their church?
Atayao.
You stealing?
Nonsense people, can you imagine what his pastor said? He said that he will do it 7 times. What kind of a statement is that? But my dear, come to think of it, maybe, I don't know. You know sometimes, Eshuluman ko le ko waja, Olotuma lo ko lo ko ko wamu. Or what do you feel? You know sometimes the way the devil behaves. Eh?
You are right too. God have mercy on you. I'm not perfect either. Bless you.
And again, what the pastor said, it's very deep. And it's only somebody that is spiritual that can understand the truth from the spirit world.
Right.
To the unbeliever, they cannot comprehend it. It's very difficult for them to understand. Because this statement is so deep, it's only someone that is full of spirit that can really get the message. Because I can't just fathom it.
You're right. It's deep. Very deep. It's very deep.
Love is our watchword. It is family. We are one. It is family. Love is our watchword.
I'm sorry. I know I must have caused you a lot of pain. I am sorry.
It's alright, son.
You still call me a son?
Yes. Because that's what you are to me. The behavior of the prodigal son did not change his status as a son, even though he suffered the consequences of his misconduct.
He ate with pigs. But as soon as he came to his senses and came back to his father, who had long been waiting for him, he was restored to his position, even with celebrations.
Daddy, I am ashamed of my decision.
Son, never let your head be bowed. May your head never be bowed in shame in Jesus' name. Raise up your head. That's what the devil wanted to achieve, to put your head down. So, ever let your head remain raised up, because God is the lifter up of your head.
Me, sir.
Son, if you are punished for your sin, you don't complain. You accept your judgment with humility of heart and repent, learn from it, and move forward. Learning, we say, only takes place when there is a change in behavior. Ronu, ma ronu nikan. Shugbon ronu ki o piwada. Okay? Son, now you tell me, how did we find ourselves in this mess?
Did you just say we? Or were you trying to say me?
If one member suffers, all suffer together. If one member is honored, all rejoice together. Son, remember this, we are in it together. So tell me, how can we find ourselves in this position? We are supposed to be in the palace and not in the cell.
That's true, Daddy. That's true. Daddy, I was tempted.
Temptation is common to all men, not few, but all men. Believers, unbelievers alike. Even Jesus, while on earth and still in human form, he was tempted in all ways. Now, the ability to use the escape way provided for you in the word of God, as Jesus did, is what makes you a victor. Or else you see yourselves disgracing the family as we are seeing it now.
Daddy, hold me, sir. Daddy,
he hold you. Tolu, did you just say he hold you? There is no he hold you without God. John 15 verse 5 says that there is no strong man or woman anywhere. We are all emotional beings who need the grace of God to survive. Now, take a fish out of water, survival means it's denied already. No God, no us. There is no me. The songwriter says, there is no me without you, Lord. You make me what I am. When I am weak, you are strong. There is no me without you, Lord. That's the truth.
There's no me without you, Lord. Oh, you make me what I am.
I faced some challenges at the family level, even at my place of work, I was having health issues then.
That's what the Bible calls tribulation. Challenges come in three different ways. A similar case is recorded in 2 Chronicles chapter 20 and Isaiah chapter 7. And when they called upon the Lord, he saved them. Oba mi ogbomo ni jake ogbomo. That's who God is.
That's true. That's true, Daddy. At that time, I approached the church several times. And the church responded like two or three times. And it got to a stage I was ashamed of coming over and over again for help. The same church, I saw people coming out to share testimonies of how they applied faith and they got results. I felt I was a burden to the church. I became so desperate. I became so desperate to look for a solution, a way out of this mess. And the temptation came. Oh, temptation. Oh, temptation.
Temptation comes when you are most vulnerable. But your response shows the state of your heart. The truth of the matter is that you will fall outside if you have already fallen inside, because the failure of the heart precedes the failure of every other organ of the body. It takes hard work to take care of the heart, because out of it are the issues of life. And immediately you realize your heart had an issue, you need a word therapy to survive. And that you must start immediately without any delay.
Have identified with a thief openly because of your reputation and that of the church.
Point of correction. Don't call him what God has not called him. Please, don't.
Don't join the devil to change his name. Learn from God. Even Jacob, the so-called supplanter, God turned into Israel. That brother is not a thief, but a child of God who fell and needs help. Remember the psalmist says, I have believed and I have seen the good of the Lord in the land of the living. Let's all believe that something good will come out of his life at the end of his all.
All right, sir. What Dickness is trying to say is that your public identification with that man is not too good. The news is all over town. Remember your status and how it will affect the body of Christ. Like now, people are calling you the father of thieves.
Now let's look at it this way. If that young man were to be announced as the president of this nation today, would I not be proud to identify myself as his father?
That one is a positive thing now.
Oh, so we only have positive events happening in the family always? You mean children don't misbehave at times? Don't they fall at times? Even after we must have warned them, don't they still go ahead and hurt themselves?
The fact remains that they'll be the ones who will bear the pains. But we all, as parents, and as people in the family, don't have a choice
than to identify with them and take care of them, even though you may still need to rebuke them and reprimand them after the whole thing.
Sir, remember that a similar thing happened when Pastor Toby was the senior pastor of the church. When that man impregnated his wife's maid and even went as far as committing abortion for the girl, and the girl died. When journalists came to interview Pastor Toby, he simply protected the church and defended the name of the church. Remember, sir?
Oh? Really? How?
We heard that the accused is your son and a member of the church. Mm-mm.
I do not have a bastard as a son. Listen, let me tell you. He doesn't belong to this family. He doesn't. Onigbagbo fiwa jo Jesu. Eni to ba ma jo mi to jo omo mi. Lo gbodo fiwa jo mi. Not a bastard.
So in one word, he has no part with you or the church.
Not at all.
Thank you very much, sir. Viewers at home, as you can see, the pastor has said he knows nothing about the whole incident. This is Joshua Mike reporting. Thank you.
He practically disowned the man and took steps, stops tongues from wagging against the church.
Excuse me, Dickness. Disowning the child doesn't rule out the fact that he or she is still your son or daughter. And that has never stopped tongues from wagging, but increases it because people believe what they want to believe. But as a good family, are you listening to me? You don't deny or throw away a child just because he or she misbehaves. Family means love. Family is a place where someone will always be there for you through both the good and the bad times. It's a place where a child is free enough to express both strengths and weaknesses, and you have the opportunity to mold his or her life practically yourself. Family is about encouragement. Family is about understanding. Family is about hope. Family is about comfort. Family is about advice. Family is about love. Family is about togetherness. Family is a place where morals, ideals, and faith are built up. Everyone in your family, in my family, is there for a reason. Now, if one fails, the entire family feels the impact of that failure.
But, sir, some members of the family are terrible and difficult to manage.
They are stubborn and rebellious.
Probably true.
But that's sometimes because we fail in our responsibility when bringing them up within the family. And most of the time, we are the ones that raise them up to be stubborn or rebellious children.
How do you mean, sir?
I'll explain. Every child thrives well in the atmosphere of love and discipline, just as rain and sunshine are good in equal proportions for the plant to grow. Family should learn how to show love enough and also how to discipline when that is necessary. But most importantly, let us show love to one another. God, our Father, used love to win us to himself. Remember John chapter 3 verse 16.
That's true.
A child you don't correct in love and on time might turn out to be stubborn. Timing and discipline are essential.
Just as Ecclesiastes chapter 8 verse 11 says that when a crime is not punished quickly, people feel it is safe to do wrong.
In this family, we must learn how to correct on time before it becomes public disgrace.
That's right, sir.
And also, a child exposed to abuse will equally not turn out to be good. They become rebellious in a matter of time.
Abuse, you say, in the church?
I can see that you are still a struggling young minister. By now, you should be so popular with your picture all over billboards and internet. And you are gifted and talented. See, if you don't mind, I can use my anointing to boost your calling. And thereby, people will be calling you all over the places. All you just need to do is to know how to take care of daddy.
Thank you very much, sir. But if I may understand your point quite clearly, you want us to have an affair, right?
Something like that. And it will be to your own advantage. It's just that I'll use my connection to connect you. People will be calling you all over the places, and you'll be winning more souls to the kingdom.
You know what, sir?
What, my daughter?
I wouldn't have minded if you wanted me to do this for the fun of the pleasure of it. But for the fact that you want me to do this for soul winning, that is the point that I don't really understand. Because if Jesus Christ had laid down his body on the cross of Calvary for souls to be saved, and here you are telling me to lay down my own body on your bed for souls to be saved. That is the point I don't think we should be talking about here. So, with due respect, sir, I think I will appreciate it if you don't discuss this with me anymore, because I would rather wait for God's appointed time and receive my own manifestation than for me to key into what you are saying now. So if you don't mind, sir, I think you should keep your anointing to yourself. Thank you very much.
Well, why pet up my goto jack bangba? You think it's easy, Ali?
Tell me, what do you expect such a daughter to turn out to be? What? There are many types of abuses going on, even right within the Church of Christ. And we need to identify them and address them. Many children are undergoing abuse, that's the truth. But what do you want them to turn out to in future? Well, anyway, what I know is that such children turn out to curse even their own parents.
Sir, we truly need help in this family.
Yes, we do. Yes,
we do. Love is our watchword. It is family. We are one.
What's oppression? Abuse? Injustice, suffering, dealing with people in manners in which they do not deserve. Now, let's read exactly from the King James Version of Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse 7. Please, my dear, can you read that?
Surely, oppression makes a wise man mad.
That is it. So who is a wise man? Someone of deep understanding with a capacity for sound judgment. Who is a madman? A madman is someone who displays extremely foolish behavior and who is unable to behave in a reasonable way. Some people you see misbehaving in the body of Christ today is really as a result of the oppression they are going through, even though that shouldn't be an excuse in any way. So, in this family, let us learn to move closer to ourselves so that we can be of help to one another, to overcome any form of oppression, be it physical or be it spiritual. Let us pray. Please say after me. Father,
Please deliver me and my household.
Please deliver me and my household.
From oppression.
From oppression.
And by your grace.
And by your grace.
Myself and my household refuse to misbehave.
Myself and my household
refuse to misbehave.
In every situation of life.
In every situation of life.
People will see our good works.
People will see our good works.
And glorify your name.
And glorify your name.
We will not in any way be involved.
We will not in any way be involved.
In anything that causes shame.
Be involved in anything that will bring shame.
So help us God.
So help us God.
In Jesus' name we pray.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
It is family. We are one.
Hello viewers at home, welcome again to your favorite show, GPTIM. This is your favorite anchor again, Peculiar Treasure. And today we'll be discussing a very important topic. We'll be talking on He Who Is Without Sin. And of course, with me in the studio today also again, I have Minister Priscilla in the house. You're welcome. You know Minister Priscilla very well. It's not a strange face to you. She's been talking to us from time to time on this show. Minister Priscilla, you're welcome again. Can you please say something to the audience?
I love you as at home. You're welcome to this power-packed program. I can assure you by the special grace of God, you will not remain the same at the end of this show.
Amen. Minister Priscilla, can you please say something about this phrase, He who is without sin?
Oh, the phrase is from Jesus' statement. He is without sin, let him be the first to cast a stone on her. Taken from the book of John chapter 8 verse 7.
Okay, can you please throw more light, elaborate on this for our viewers to have a better grasp of what you're saying?
No problem. Jesus was teaching in the temple one day when the scribes and Pharisees came to him with a woman caught in the very act of adultery. They wanted to ask Jesus of what to do to her, whether to stone her according to the laws of Moses. Not like they cared about the woman, but they just wanted to trap Jesus. You know, in their mind, if Jesus had told them to set the woman free, they would have said he never held on to the law of Moses. If Jesus had told them to stone the woman to death, you know, they would have said he wasn't the savior he claimed to be. And if he did not even see anything, they would have said he lacked wisdom. And then Jesus stood down, writing on the ground. Obviously, he did not answer them at first. But when they pressed him further, Jesus stood up from the ground and then said to them, if there is anyone among you without sin, let him be the first to cast a stone on her. After hearing this, they all left one by one, starting from the older ones. Then Jesus was left in the center with the woman and asked her a question. Woman, where are thine accusers? Has no one condemned thee? And then she replied, Jesus, saying, no one, sir, no one has condemned me. And then Jesus said to her, he said, neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more.
Wonderful. But what could Jesus be writing on the ground that made them live like that?
Okay, we really do not know what Jesus wrote on the ground. But we know that somehow, some way, those who might have looked or might have seen something that convicted them. You know, that simple gesture of Jesus portrayed Jesus as a divine legislator. Jesus stooped to the ground and was writing on it. This could be likened to the fingers of God writing on the tablets of stones. Jesus being the word of God himself, he knew the Torah. He knew the law required two righteous witnesses to condemn anyone.
Oh, that's true. That's true. So, if a woman was caught in the act of adultery, there should be a man committing the act with her. The man was not brought. What happened?
That's the point. That's the point. There was no doubt that the woman committed a capital offense for which she should be stoned to death, obviously. But my question is, where was the man with whom she committed the adultery with? The law required that he also be stoned as well.
Okay. But what I think is, it's possible those guys knew that it was the woman that actually seduced the man into the act, and she was fined and culpable as guilt.
Oh, actually, it takes two to tango.
Oh, that's true. That's true. But when sensitive issues like this come up, for example, let's say a man of God was caught in the act of adultery, or something like that happens to somebody that is of prominence in the society, the woman is always found culpable. They say maybe she has the Jezebel spirit, or even in some cases when marriages don't work, the blame is always placed on the woman. Are we saying that we are in a gender biased society, or what do you think? And in some cases when even the children don't turn out well, the blame is still put on the woman. Anyway, before you respond to this, let's quickly go on a break. We'll be back after this short clip. So viewers, welcome back. This is still your Vifri channel, GPTIM, your favorite anchor, God's peculiar treasure. And of course, we are still discussing in what happens in this, our family. Minister Priscilla is still here. We are on the topic, who is without sin? Before we left, there was where we put this. We're coming back there. We were discussing about the society. Can you please tell us why our society finds it easy to put blame on women rather than men?
You know, because it takes a man of great humility and great maturity to own up and accept his blame. A very good example is Adam, who had committed a sin, and instead of accepting his guilt, out of shame, tried to shift blames. Little wonder why he blamed God and he blamed his wife eventually.
Blamed God and his wife?
Yes. Of course.
That's absurd.
He said, the woman blaming the wife, whom you, blaming God, gave to me, did this. You know, Adam laid the foundation of shifting blame. After falling into temptation, human beings just like Adam will foolishly attempt to cover their sins from God. And after it is even discovered, rather than own up, confess, and forsake the sins, they rather shift blames.
God, this is deep! Oh my God, this is Rema! How I wish Sister Dorcas and Brother David are watching this program in their house. Ki Oluwa ki o ba mi fun oni eti gbo ati ayagba se. I pray that my God will grant them listening ears and obedient hearts. This is a powerful revelation, my dear. Powerful revelation.
One of our fathers in the Lord said, and I quote, "Revelation is not revelation if it cannot change you."
Meaning?
1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 16. Bible admonishes us to pay close attention to oneself first.
Well, but then, 1 Timothy chapter 2 verse 14 says, Adam was not deceived, but the woman that was the one that was deceived and was caught in the transgression. So probably that was the reason why the blame had to be shifted to her.
You know, okay. The question to ask is, where was Adam when the serpent was engaging his wife in a discussion? He failed in his responsibility as a leader and a guardian of his wife.
So you're saying that they were both guilty?
Both of them are guilty. Oh. You know, God asked the woman, "What have you done?" Even though her response still shifted blame, but it was more direct and apologetic. She could have said, "My husband didn't give me attention. My husband didn't make me understand your instructions well. Or better still," she could have said, "Well, you know, the one who gave me a man who didn't love me enough to spend time with me." But instead, she said, "The serpent deceived me and I hurt." You know, she was able to identify the culprit behind the action, even though we all know that a man falls into temptation when he's drawn away by his own evil desires. You know, she saw the tree and found that it was good for food. She plucked the fruit and she ate it. Now note, it was a desire that got her into temptation. Now let me sound this very well. Until you stop looking for whom to blame for your mistakes or for your wrongdoings, you're not yet a candidate of God's forgiveness.
Well, the woman in chapter 8 realized she was guilty. She realized she was in that sin. She pleaded for mercy. She got it. But those that were in the accusing camp, do you think they can ever receive God's mercy?
The question you should ask is, who are the accusers? The accusers are those who know the law and can quote it accurately. You know, they are full of "thou shalt not," but their secret lives are nothing to write home about. They are quick to judge sinners, of which they are chief. Jesus knew about their secret lives. Maybe that was what they even saw while he was writing on the ground. But it's so surprising that those who brought a sinner to be judged were sinners themselves.
We need to ask for forgiveness of every idle words that proceeded out of our mouth.
Wow. That is the irony of life indeed. Viewers, I think we have learned so much today. Minister Priscilla, do you have like a parting word for our viewers at home?
Yes, I do. And this is it. Please, stop using your mouth to stone people to death by criticizing, by condemning, and by judging them. In so doing, your sin will also find you out.
We are heirs of the kingdom. We are joint heirs with the Son. We are children of the kingdom. We are families. We are one. We are heirs of the Father. We are joined with the Son. Hey! We are children.
I've been looking for a girl like this.
Oh, really?
Look at who you are dressing. You haven't put it on chain. And you call yourself a Christian. You are a disgrace to this family. I mean the body of Christ. I'm not sure you are born again. If you are, you will know that a child of God does not dress this way. Let me preach the shortest sermon to you. You are on your fastest lane to hell. Nonsense. Hey, you come. Good afternoon. Look at the way you two. Hey, lady! Are you telling me you're a Christian, like the way you're dressing like this, in trousers? Hey, Christian, no?
Mommy, I really appreciate your care for my soul, even for everyone's souls. I have a word for you. The people you are condemning, how would you know if they have truly repented? No wonder the Bible says, judge not. As we all know, God did not send his Son to condemn the world, but to save them. If you don't know what to say to get people saved, then you are working against Jesus' mission. Thank you. Mind you, you need to pay attention to your children.
Speaking in Luke chapter 18 from verse 9 to 14. It speaks volume of two men, a tax collector and a Pharisee. The Pharisee came to the temple and he began to recount how he's been faithful with tithe paying. In fact, at some point he began to look down on the tax collector. Scripture records that the tax collector stood afar off, not wanting to go close to God. And then because he felt he was filthy, he stood there, beating his chest severally. Oh God, turn your wrath away from me, a sinner. One of them went home justified. Let us be like Jesus. He doesn't want any man to perish. He wants everyone to come to repentance. Thank you.
Oh, thank you so much, Minister Priscilla.
It's a pleasure.
Oh, viewers, as we round up this program today, I want to say a big thank you to every one of you for sticking with us. And Minister Priscilla, once again, thanks for coming.
It's a pleasure.
We've learned so much today. Well, viewers, as we round up on this program today, I want to borrow some leave from what we just heard from our minister, Minister Priscilla. I want to say that one major lesson to me, summarized in Matthew chapter 7, verse 1, is that the Bible says, do not judge, or you will be judged. And the time where you are pointing an accusing finger to somebody or at somebody else, you might be found culpable of the same offense. And if your sin is discovered, you might find a greater shame than if you had not been in that quagmire. Till we meet next week, on this same channel, GBTIM, same anchor, Peculiar Treasure, same program in this family. God bless you. And don't forget, like I always say, in this family, love is our watchword. Bye.
Oh, Becky, Dabi, Jesus.
We pray for forgiveness. Forgive us, we have gone astray. Have mercy on us. Father, forgive us. Forgive us for all our trespasses. For this unfaithfulness, forgive us. Father, forgive us. Forgive us for our failures, for our weakness. Lord, we pray you forgive us.
Jesus, me, Lord,
to be like you, every day, every hour, every minute, every second, and your Father.
In His family, love is our watchword. In His family, we are one. In His family, love is our watchword.
Please, let me suggest, should we not say that we should indulge the stubborn ones among us? Because the Bible says in Deuteronomy chapter 21, verse 18 to 21, it said, if a man have a stubborn and rebellious son, which will not obey the voice of his father, or the voice of his mother, and that when they have chastened him, be not hearken unto them, then shall his father and his mother lay hold on him and bring him out unto the elders of the city, unto the gate of his place. And they shall say unto the elders of the city, this our son is stubborn and rebellious. He will not obey our voice. He is a glutton and a drunkard. And all the men of the city shall stone him with stones that he die. So shall thou put evil away from among you. And all Israel shall hear and fear. You know, this is what the Bible is talking about. You know, when it's talking about a rebellious or stubborn child, that this is what we're supposed to do to him.
Now, okay, now you tell me. Now, can you stone anybody to death now without being charged or prosecuted for that?
No, sir. Never.
But the fact remains that we use our mouth to condemn people to death with judgment. Jesus says in the Word that we should judge not, so we should not be judged. We use our mouths to create a hostile and toxic environment for people, and this makes it difficult for them to survive.
But you are right, Daddy. You are right, sir. But it seems some denominations are better loved than some other denominations in a way. Yet we are the same family.
The truth of the matter is that we are all sick in one way or the other. A denomination may be good in one area, while it is weak in another. Jesus has not come to condemn the world. He rather came for those that are sick. We all have our own peculiar areas of infirmity. We're not just talking about sicknesses and diseases of the flesh. We are talking about those areas where we are yet to be firm. Denomination or no denomination, we are all same family, and we need to look after one another. We need to help one another. We must learn to fight our weaknesses together. When a drug is administered to a sick person, every part of that sick person's body has a role to play in making the drug work. The head might be the aching part, but the buttock may be the one to take the injection. They all feel the pain, but together work towards finding a solution to the problem.
That's right, sir. That's right.
Now let me shock you a little bit. There's always a little piece of feces in every buttock that makes it to smell. If you don't mind, can you let me smell yours?
And let's see if it will not smell. I need to smell it.
That is it. That's the question. What that means is that we all have one area or the other where we must still rely on God for help. Hmm. That means we need each other's help, and mostly we need God's help 24/7.
You are right, Daddy, sir. You are right, sir. We really need help.
Let me tell you one.
Yes, sir.
Some are not really falling down. And that may be because the occasion has not given itself for them to fall.
Hmm.
Not until you are alone with a beautiful sister and you don't lose in your heart, not even to talk of physical falling, can you claim to be standing. According to Jesus' definition of sin, thinking of doing it in your heart has already made you a sinner, because if the opportunity appears, you will be first. When you don't steal money, if you have the opportunity, that's when you can proudly say that God has helped you. You remember what Jesus said in John chapter 8, verses 6 and 7? Please, can you read that?
John chapter 8, 6 to 7.
Yeah.
This they said, tempting him, that they might have to accuse him. But Jesus stooped down and with his finger wrote on the ground, as though he heard them not. So when they continued asking him, he lifted up his head and said unto them, he that is without sin among you, let him first cast a stone at her.
Now, Jesus knew those people were under the control of the spirit of religion. Mm. And that's the spirit that is very good at pointing accusing finger, because it knows only laws. That's the do's and the don'ts. Mm. But most times, it's not perfect in judgment.
Yes, sir.
Imagine, they brought a woman caught in the very act of adultery, but they couldn't produce the man involved.
Mm. Mm.
Many are just simply being controlled by this terrible spirit. Only few people hear what the spirit is saying to the church.
I think the issue is that I think it's high time that our elders in faith rose up to this task. Our situation requires urgent attention. The problem is that most of these elders are themselves falling. We are in a serious dilemma.
It's high time that people learned that we are just human.
Mm.
It's only the grace of God in us that makes a difference, and that's what the people call us, men of God, because that's what we really are. But anytime we leave God in out of our decision, we become ordinary flesh. Even God said in Genesis chapter 6 verse 3 that men, including men of God, are flesh. It is only the Holy Spirit in our lives that makes the difference. Now, you don't expect too much from anybody. You must learn to give them the benefits of the doubt, and that's the allowance of being human beings. When you are too overconfident, you just fall cheaply. It takes the grace of God. But unfortunately today, the church has raised a generation that rebukes our leaders with ease, even when there's a clear instruction in the Bible telling us not to do that. 1 Timothy chapter 5 and verse 1.
Can I ask you a question?
Yes, sir.
When last did you take out time to pray for your leaders?
Every leader needs prayer now more than ever. Paul said, brethren, pray for us. I think people should just go and learn from Noah's children, as not to attract unnecessary curses on their destinies.
Father, deliver me from this judgmental spirit. Deliver me from judgmental spirit. Have mercy on me. Father, I am so sorry that I have been receiving the revelation of your word for people and never for myself.
May God help us to attain the higher level of maturity in Christ.
Amen.
We stop the oppression of every spirit of resistance against the truth of the Word of God in our lives and in God's family, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Auntie Dina, when will you stop crying? What has happened has happened. Or do you want to kill yourself?
Why will she cry? The news has spread all over the place.
Ha! Brother can spread rumor, eh?
You should have known that sin is not a respecter of anybody. That's why the Bible admonishes us to flee from all appearance of evil.
I was raped.
You were raped?
I was raped. I don't know why it's difficult for brethren to believe the old truth. I'm saying the truth.
Why won't they believe? Love believe all things.
Yes, sir. Did you tell anyone that you were raped before the appearance of this pregnancy?
But I have told someone. I was afraid. I didn't want to be stigmatized by anyone, so I kept it to myself.
But you should have confided in your pastor now.
Pastor, anything you tell him, the old judge will hear about it. It will be all over the world. I can't talk to him. I can't.
Ha! That's what we call spiritual mouth diarrhea.
The most painful thing. The thing that pained me the most is that the pastor said my number has been removed from the WhatsApp group of the church.
And you are crying as if they remove your name from the book of life.
Thank God. God will never entrust this book into hands of any man. Because he knows that we can remove the name of our pastor if we are offended.
As if that is not enough. He said he has removed the umbrella of grace. The covering of grace on me. Oh my God.
They removed ordinary umbrella and you are crying. Come to our church. You will enjoy decking and cannabis of grace. What kind of church is that? That's why some ministers raise causes on their members.
As if they receive their calling from the devil.
Rubbish.
Papa, take it easy now. Are we no longer members of the same family? None of us have arrived at perfection. God wants us to strengthen each other's weaknesses. Let's see how we resolve this amicably.
Somebody telling that you love him. Lift your hands together. Let's praise the Lord, yeah.
In this family, love is our watchword. In this family, we are one.
There's no me without you, Lord. You make me what I am. When I'm weak, you're always strong. There's no me without you, Lord. No me without you, Lord.
Lord, I want to be like
to
you.
Be like Jesus.
In my heart.
Lord, I want to be like Jesus in my heart.
Hello, viewers at home, you are welcome again to your program, our program, In This Family. I still remain your anchor, Peculiar Treasure. And once again today, we have Minister Priscilla in the studio. I'm sure somebody is excited about that. Minister Priscilla, you're welcome.
Yes.
Can you say something to the viewers?
I love viewers at home. I ask that God blesses you in this moment.
Thank you very much. All right, let's get straight down to business of the day. Remember the last time we were on this show, you said that in this family, we must stay close and stick to one another until somebody proves to be a pastor.
Yes, we have to grow together, all things being equal.
But at times, you should know, like I know very well, that we have black sheep in the family. So how do we handle such?
Yes, because we have a black sheep in the family does not make everyone a black sheep.
I agree with you. How come then that we find black sheep in the family?
Okay, a good name can be solved by a family member. And you know that's exactly what's happening in these times. And it is so sad.
Mm.
I want you to know that it's sometimes not even the fault of the family member, the so-called black sheep. A lot of factors responsible.
Yeah.
Factors such as rejection,
lack
of love, lack of firmness and discipline.
Okay.
And so, duty beholds on every family member to be committed to building an optimal family. I want you to know that family affects the society, impacts the society.
Oh, yeah, okay.
And just the same, the society impacts the country.
Mm.
So it is our duty as family members to be role models to this society where we are, or to the country where we are in.
And also to ourselves.
And also to ourselves, yeah.
All right. I agree with you because, you know, of course I know that there are different levels of development in the family.
Yeah, true. Sure.
Can you say something?
Yes, the point is, like you said.
Because why I said that is, I know that you can't, if you talk about being role models, training ourselves, I know that you can't apply the same method to everybody.
Yes.
Based on developmental stages.
Yes.
So I want you to say something about that.
Yes. I want you to understand that these stages cut across infants, toddlers, teenagers, youth, young adults, and even the aged. I realize that utmost and undivided attention is usually given to youth. Not the guise of the fact that they are the future of tomorrow. However true that may seem, it is somewhat selfish. So what happens to the babies, the toddlers, the teenagers? What happens to them? I mean, those times, they're in their formative years, and whatsoever is received in those years, shaping and form their values, their virtues, and their intellect.
Mm.
Also, in respect of the aged and the young adults, I mean, they should not be neglected also. They should be given enough care, proportionate, and balanced, so that they can become better persons. It must be understood that balanced provision of care and attention must be given to these age groups, if not to be impoverished.
Thank you so much.
That's
comprehensive enough. You know?
It's a pleasure.
You know, because you know, I believe that every society knows that you should have basic needs.
Yes.
You know, for this different demography you just mentioned.
Yes.
Alright, can you talk to the audience on this a little?
Oh, the basic needs include clothing, shelter, food, discipline, prayer, and a lot more. And I'm going to be talking shortly on all of these things I've mentioned. First of all, I'm going to be talking about food. We all know what food is to the body, and should be given according to age for development and growth. Overfeeding and underfeeding should be verily avoided.
That's also true in the real life.
Yes, very, very true.
Mm.
You must understand that in this family, too much of programs does not guarantee spiritual growth. So we must understand that we need not allow these people to choke, but give them a breathing space for healthy living, physically and spiritually.
Thank you very much. Okay, you said you were going to talk about clothing too.
Yes, clothing.
Mm.
We all know what clothing is all about. Clothing covers our nakedness. It precludes us from bad weather. Simply say, it protects us from cold. So how do we cover each other? How do we cover each other's nakedness? Get people to see.
Oh, this is deep.
Warning. Oh my God, Jesus, have mercy.
I think I have an idea. You know, you and this Yoruba.
Oh my God.
I told you have to do something about this.
But
I think what you wanted to say was, I will need Bowo.
Exactly.
See, I will be, I will need Bowo.
Thank you. Scripture speaking in Psalms chapter 133 says that God will command blessings where unity reigns. I want you to understand today that it is not that we are saying we should condone sin or iniquity, but all we are saying in essence is that we fight our weaknesses in unity.
So I think I need to make this a little clearer to the audience. Mm-hmm. What she meant by I will need Bowo, for those of you that might not get what that means, you know, it means that if somebody fails in the family, then another member of the family should do everything to protect.
Yes, very
and,
well.
And that's what she actually meant by clothing.
Yes.
Okay, you also mentioned shelter.
Yes. We all know that shelter is for security purposes. And so we must understand that in this family, we do not create a toxic environment, but saturated with God's love.
Thank you so much. I think gradually we are coming to the end of today's show, but then I don't want us to just gloss over this, because we talked about discipline too as part of the basic needs.
Yes.
So in under 30 seconds to 1 minute, can you say something that we can put on record?
Discipline. Now we must understand something, that discipline must be meted out of love. Scripture speaking in Psalms chapter 23 verse 4 says that even though I walk through the valley, even though I walk, personal decision, through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. You would still follow me. You would still be with me, even if it was my decision. Your rod, it means discipline. And your staff, it means direction, comforts me. The question we need to ask ourselves is, the discipline we met out, are they to condemn people or they are for comfort and correction? These are foods for our thoughts. And also, we'll talk about prayer. We must understand that prayer is very peculiar to this family.
It's like the air that we breathe, actually.
Yes, very, very peculiar. As it helps us face temptations, and he also words of demonic oppositions. I think that will be all from my angle.
Oh, thank you very much, Minister Priscilla. So, viewers at home, I am sure you have been so blessed. We have learned so much today. As a matter of fact, there are things you would never know that add spiritual connotation. And she was actually able to relate them to the spiritual world. Sincerely speaking, today has been a great day. So, and as we sign off on this program today, I just want to remind you that in this family, love is our watchword. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Dina, I am really sorry I treated you in a non-Jesus way. I was disappointed. Nevertheless, I shouldn't have judged you with my words and actions. Who am I to have said you are removed from the umbrella of grace of the church Jesus died for? If to Jesus you remain a daughter, why would I name you a bastard? Jesus loves you and wants you restored, and that's all that matters to him. Since that's all that matters to him, that must be all that matters to me too. This church is your home, and we are your family. You're welcome back, my dear daughter.
Lord, I want to be like Jesus in my heart.
From the swamp.
Once again, I welcome everybody to this church council meeting. And obviously you can see I am very happy. I am very delighted. My son and child is back.
Hallelujah.
Not only back, but fully restored unto us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
I can say that God has forgiven him, and the church here has accepted him fully back here with us.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah. In this family, there shall be no more loss.
Amen.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Please, can we begin to give thanks to God? Let us bless him, for he is good.
Thank you, Jesus.
For his mercies endures forever.
In his family, love is our watchword. In his family, we are one. In his family, love is our watchword.
With the Son, we are children of the kingdom. We are families, we are one. We are heirs of the Father. We are joined with the Son. Your children of the kingdom of our Father. We are families. We are one. We one. We one.
In his family.
Yes, in this family.
Love is our watchword.
Love is our password. Come on. Yes, sir.
We are one.
Yes.
In his family.
Love is the code in this family. Yes, sir. Come on.
Jesus,
so soon we're gonna meet.